Hey, it's Tuesday at 6 o'clock. You know what that means. It's time for Total Schmidt Show. This is Glen Foster's episode. You heard me, Glen Foster. Sit back, Glen Foster. This is your episode for my good friend, Glen Foster. Here we go.
Hey, welcome to Total Schmidt Show. How you doing? I'm back at sea. Here's what you're going to get from the show. It's kind of like quarantine comedy, except I'm not going to be home.
Actually, it's kind of like quarantine comedy and a combination of all the stuff I've done online over the last year or so. There's sketch stuff, live stuff, stand-up stuff, travel stuff, and of course, conversations with others who do the same things that I do on a daily basis.
That's it. That's the whole show. Then I'm going to record it all and put it on the intraweb. Sometimes. Usually late. Always late. Maybe, I don't know. And weekly? Maybe. Sort of. Could be.
Either way, sit back. I hope you enjoy whatever the hell it is I put together for this week on Total Schmidt Show. Hey guys, welcome to Total Schmidt Show. I joke about Glen Foster for a specific reason. I'll let you know in just a second. Thanks for tuning into the show. Once again, we're here every Tuesday, 6 o'clock. I talk to entertainers all over the world. Do me a favor. First of all, subscribe to the YouTube channel. That would really help me out immensely. Here are my socials. They're over here somewhere. I'm pretty sure that's where they're going after I edit this video. Enjoy the show. This is everything here on the Lenny Schmidt Comedy Network. Enjoy all the shows for free, or you can pay if you can. There's a little ticker above me that will play throughout the show on and off. We have no sponsors here, and the Lenny Schmidt Comedy Network and all my videos are supported by my subscribers, my followers, and anyone that wants to support us financially. You can do all kinds of options right up there. Go to payifucan.com, and all the options are listed right there for you. My Venmo, Mr. Lenny Schmidt, Cash App, all that stuff. If you want to support the show financially, we would appreciate it. Otherwise, just subscribe to the channel. It's really important. This is a great episode with my good friend Glen Foster, who's a magician and an agent. And I forgot how great this episode was. It's a little bit of a longer one. We talked about a lot of stuff. We talked about magic, how he started out. We talked about his travels, our travels, COVID. We talked about investing, talked about money. We talked about being present. We talked about paying forward. We talked about life in general. It was a great episode. We talked about some really cool stuff. Sit back and enjoy my conversation with the one and only Mr. Glen Foster.
Carnival Magic, let me hear you make some noise! Come on! That's just the Carnival Glory, I just realized that.
So how long have you do both? How long have you been a magician? You got a lot going on, dude. You're like a magician. You're handling talent. You got yeah. You know, you're first of all, your show is great.
Thank you.
I love anybody that puts a message into the stuff. Thanks. That's really significant. You know what I mean? That puts a lot of thought process into it. And something that's really that blows me away is you have to sync yourself with the video behind you.
Yeah.
And not look at, you know, I don't know if right. I can do that. That takes a lot of...
Well, where the rehearsal is, you play the video on a monitor so you can see it and
right.
You practice that version of it, you know, and you have to, it's a timing. I use a lot of beats. There's beats in my head that I'm memorized, you
right.
know, so I just know certain segments, this is where this is coming up and I have to be ready. It's also a timing. It lets me know if I'm too early or I'm too far behind. And so when you have a big video playing behind you, even though you're not looking at it, sometimes you can glance and get a peek out of your peripheral.
Right, right.
So you can see kind of where you're at on the time.
Ladies and gentlemen, that rope right there represents the kids in our family. The media rope, this represents our moms. You would think my love was the long skinny one, this represents our dad. Our dad. Remember this. That's one, two, three. Thank you.
But you know what helps you, I think, in that is the music. The beat of the music helps big time, because then you're like two, and then you know the line. You know, you're counting it out essentially.
Yeah. So yeah, it's almost like counting out like a dancer does steps.
It's exactly like steps. That.
It's exactly what it is. And I learned that from my mentor Jeff O'Lear. I had two mentors in magic. I had Jeff O'Lear, and who's in Pennsylvania, who had a very successful touring magic group with a cast. Like, he traveled with, like, you know, 10, 12 people, setting up a massive illusion show called Change the World was the name of the show. And he did it for years on a tour bus. And then in 2000, he retired. And when I was starting to do illusions, the bigger stuff in 2000, that's when I reached out, met him, basically. And come small world. He and I had actually worked together.
Keep going on.
And we met each other in Puerto Rico. So he was my mentor when I started doing illusions. And then Steve Zygmunt was my other mentor. He had a very successful Egyptian themed magic illusion show. And so I was his roadie for a couple of years. But I started doing magic when I was 15, when I was in Puerto Rico. And then I met Amazing Randy, who inherited many of Harry Houdini's equipment. So,
oh, really?
Yeah. He was in Puerto Rico with an escapist. And Dean Gunnarsson, and he taught me the straitjacket. Dean was actually doing the straitjacket at the fort in Mojito in Puerto Rico, hanging upside down on a crane 100 feet in the air.
Oh, geez.
Yeah. So they were promoting some kind of thing. It was promoted by Bacardi rum. So I spent
that sounds safe.
I know, right?
Drink a little rum, hang from a. That doesn't seem like a good
spot. Have some of this, and we're going to put you in a straitjacket and hang you 100 feet in the air with the wind blowing and see how you do.
Yeah, drink this rum. It's the only way. It sounds like the sponsor should be like hard helmets or, you know what I mean? Something like bungee cords.
That's
or,
right. Back then, I don't think bungee cords even existed, to be honest with you. So.
Right.
No, but that's what I learned, man. And so I spent a week with those guys. And Dean Gunnarsson, I believe, still does escapes. He's a Canadian guy. Mm-hmm. And then Amazing Randy lives actually in Orlando, Florida area. So so they taught me a lot of stuff. And just like in comedy, you know, they have people who teach you the ropes, you know, and being around people and helps you understand dynamics, helps you understand staging. I wrote a lot of books on, showmanship.
Yeah.
And I think at the end of the day, I mean, you can be funny, but in my line of work as a comedy magician, I do magic and then I try to make it comedic in that situation.
Right.
I'll tell you a funny story. When I was in Puerto Rico, I was 17 years old and I was doing a show for about 150 people.
Okay.
And back then, I wanted to be, you know, like all of us, I was about this big, very big.
Right.
And I was trying to, I did this show, had 10 tricks, and I was trying to be like David Copperfield. 9 out of my 10 tricks didn't work.
Right.
Now, when I say they didn't work, it means that I got through them, but it wasn't like what I wanted them to be. And after the show, almost the entire group came up and they were telling me, shaking hands, saying thank you. And they said it was the funniest comedy magic show they've ever seen. And it was at that point that I realized maybe that's what I need to pursue. And that's so that's where I've been at.
You embrace, dude. You know what I did? You embrace the, maybe there's something here.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I used to, when I started doing the Quarantine Comedy Show last year, a big part of my base that I built early, they tuned in because I screwed up constantly. Uh-huh. Like I told you, I didn't go to school and study it.
Right.
I just dove in
and
started doing stuff. And John DeCrosta is a comic we've mentioned a couple times. He used to tune in all the time to see my backdrops fall. And I would do episodes for 2 minutes with no sound. And I would stream live. The only thing that saved me was streaming live because people would make comments and there'd be sound, 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 sound. And I'd have to turn it back on and go, thanks a lot, guys. I appreciate it. So people just tuned in to see, you know, how many screw-ups I would make.
Well, I think COVID taught all of us a very valuable lesson. And that is that as entertainers, your income could be gone like that.
Yeah.
And one of the things that I've had been fortunate enough is I've had people teach me the value of saving money, investing, and not living day to day. You know, a lot of sometimes entertainers, that's how we are. So when we went through COVID, which was like horrible, I was able to do a couple of Zoom shows, you know.
Yeah.
I live in Florida, so we didn't shut down 100%, so to speak. So I was still able to do some like 55 plus community shows.
Right.
Anything theater wise where there's big groups of gathering, like, you know, that people were paying to come to see, all got canceled. Normally during the summer I tour and I do about 80 to 100 library shows. Like I'll be doing 3 to 4 shows a day, picking up, setting down,
right,
tearing down. I mean,
wow, really? And, 3 to 4 a day?
Yeah. Dude, and on weekends,
that's hustling,
Saturdays
bro.
And Sundays sometimes. Yeah. Some of the libraries would even book you for Sundays. And so we went from doing like 80 to 100 shows in 6 weeks.
Yeah.
So that's a heavy schedule.
Dude, yeah.
And but Ken Scott Whitaker was one of the guys who basically, or I'm not sure his last name, but Ken Scott is out of Atlanta. And he kind of inspired me to do more shows outside of Florida. And then my mentor, Jeff, he said, Glenn, just put a period on a map and make a 4-hour radius. Figure out what price point you want to be at, and then just go hit it. And that's exactly what I did. And I, of course, I traveled out of state. I was in St. Louis, Missouri area.
Right.
I was in O'Fallon, Illinois, Southern Illinois area. I did shows in Georgia. I did 10 shows in North Carolina. I did like 20 some shows in Florida. And it's so you learn to adjust and adapt. And COVID taught me that, same as you, I had to learn, you know, doing the Zoom shows.
Yeah.
And one of the things I learned, because some of the places would, you know, broadcast a show live on Facebook or YouTube. And the problem with that, a guy like myself, I use a lot of music in my show for, you know, to make it fun.
Mm-hmm.
And so if music's not royalty free, they will shut you down.
Right, right. Uh-huh.
And so the adjustment that I had to make during this time frame of COVID is doing my entire show just talking, no music.
Wow, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
So like even that puzzle piece you saw that I just did, which kind of is a tribute to my mom, I had to do that with no music. So the timing and pacing is totally different.
Yeah.
But what you saw, that was like the 13th and 14th time I've actually performed it live for an audience with that music, with that video that I edited in the background.
Right.
Because, you know, a lot of us went through a lot of hard times. You know, we all have, you know. And so I think this country and our world in general has had we need to be reminded that these things can pass, you know, and we got to learn to work together as a team. And I think there's so many entertainers out there a lot of times that are just trying to bash other people who are in the entertainment industry. And we're all one family, you know. We need to support each other. We need to be happy that people are working. You know, are we all working where we want to be? No, probably not. But at the same time, you know, we want to make sure that we're supportive of each other. And I've been fortunate enough as a fly on that, because normally when I work on the ships, I fly in, do my show, go home. Like I'm like literally 2 or 3 days on a ship.
Right,
but
right.
Since July 3rd, since we started back working on the ships, for me, the blessing has been hanging out with people like yourself, you know, hanging out with people like, you know, George and Eddie and some of these other comics, DaCosta, who you mentioned earlier.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
We'd hang out and we would laugh till wee hours in the morning and just, you know, jabbing at each other and having a great time. And so that to me has been a blessing, because a lot of times I never would cross paths, you know, with the comics, you know, like I said, fly in, do my show, go home. But this has been awesome for me, to be honest with you.
Yeah. One of the cool things, like even before COVID, when we used to do crossings, I used to appreciate those gigs, because they would load the ship with entertainers.
Right.
Because you have like 6 CDs or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So you would have like a magician, there'd be a singer, there'd be a juggler, there'd be 4 comics, there'd be all kinds of people.
Right.
And we hung out the whole time. We had lunch every day. I mean, we've had lunch, we're going to dinner tonight.
Yep.
That's a cool thing. Like, even though sometimes you're like, I don't want to be gone 7 days. I can look at the other 7 days and I can do work during the day.
Sure.
And really embrace. And I'll be honest with you, at the beginning, it was kind of it was like a vacation, you know. Mm-hmm. I'm like, it's back to, because I worked my ass off during COVID, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I did Uber and all kinds of side jobs and restaurants. And
So
when I got back here, you suddenly remember, you're like, oh, I remember what this is like now.
Right.
To be doing shows at night and working out.
Well, that's the thing about, you know, as entertainers, you know, we figure out whatever it takes to get the job done, you know, provide for our families, obviously, you know, so you're not the only one who's done that. You know,
right.
I did odd jobs too. I have a CNA license. I'm a certified nursing assistant. So I took care of elderly people throughout the week as well, you know, take care of them and do their grocery shopping. And I dealt with some people who were really sick, you know, and then I would be able to do little magic tricks for them, you know.
So
these people
are
80, 90 years old, and they're like, oh, that's great. And then one guy actually hired me to do a show for their family for post 4th of July celebration, for a birthday party bash they were having. So, and the guy goes, hey, would you mind if you did a show, and would you pay me? I'm like, you don't have to pay me, I'll just do it for you guys. No, we gotta pay you. And they had 23 people sitting in their living room, and we had a blast. I did a 40 minute show for them. It was awesome.
Dude, that's the best.
Yeah.
I used to work in a retirement home in Illinois.
Okay.
And I was a cook before I did stand up. I was into cooking. It was a line cook, chef, mm-hmm. apprentice and stuff. But it was a small retirement home. I've worked in a few, actually, retirement homes.
Right.
One couple of big corporate ones, but this one was small, so I knew everyone. I knew all the people. And I would come in and I would make I'd make food for them, and then I'd serve the food.
Right.
And everything's a different menu. You can't eat salt, it's got to be pureed.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a couple of people that used to come in the kitchen and argue, and they wanted certain foods. And I go, I can't give you ice cream today, Kathy, or whatever.
Yeah.
But I was Santa Claus for them the one year. And I came out as Santa Claus, did the whole Santa thing, you know, and I came out and served dinner that night. And she was, Maria, she's so sweet. She goes, you were a great Santa Claus. And I go, Santa was here? she's like, oh, shut up. I go, no, I didn't know Santa was here. Really?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, it was great. I love doing that, man. It was great.
Yeah, the last guy I took care of, they keep messaging me. I've been gone, like I said, since July 3rd doing ships. And he says, when are you coming back? He's 90. 4 years old.
That's great, man.
And I just tell him, I'm like, dude, if I can be your age and be as mobile as you are and as happy, and I mean, that's a goal.
How great would that be, right?
And the guy, he's just another great guy, you know. And so Mr. Glasgow is his name. And so he's like, when you coming back, man?
Oh, that's great.
Messages me. But it's all good. But, you know, we got to do what we got to do, you know.
Right, right.
Because those jobs don't necessarily, it's an interim. It's an in-between stuff, you know, because we do the other stuff.
Well, we did like 180, 190 episodes of that quarantine show. And mm-hmm. that's what I talked to everybody about. And it was interesting to find. Some guys really struggled, man. They couldn't figure out what to do. They couldn't get anything.
Right.
Other guys reinvented themselves to a point. Like Colin Moulton, I don't know if you know who he is. He's mm-hmm. a comic. Dude, he's a comic. He's a very funny guy. He's been doing shifts, does all kinds of stuff. But he ended up doing these corporate gigs, and he built a studio at his house and built a market for himself. And I was so both motivated and impressed to see that guys do that. It makes mm-hmm. you really think about. It really made me think about things like World War II. And
right.
I mean, we've been kind of blessed here. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Most of our lives, we have our freedom. We're in America. We know mm-hmm. we haven't had a lot of, there was the recession. There was the money, the housing market.
Right.
You know, I mean, there's things that have happened.
Sure.
But nothing that's completely changed our lives like COVID.
No.
Yeah. And the
lesson we should all learn as entertainers from this situation is to have a nest egg.
Yes.
You know, it's one of the things I've been teaching my children is that, listen, I hope to God they never have to go through this again.
Right.
But if you look back in time, you know, you look at what happened in, 9/11, that was in 2001. Then in 2008, a few years later, we had a big crash, you know, and so now this last one was another 12 years after that. So there seems to be, and if you go back and look at stuff, there are all these trends that take place. And I think it's important as entertainers that we develop the ideology of just, you know, creating that nest egg, because most of us don't have like retirement pension plans. Most of us, I mean, I do, but most people, comics or whatever. And, that's different. So when you mentioned earlier about representation, I do represent as an agent. I book other entertainers and comedians, magicians, ventriloquists, different kinds of things, because I realized Ray Kroc, the founder of McDonald's, he said something that was very interesting early on in one of his books, is that he didn't want 100% of the profit of the hamburger. All he wanted was one penny from every burger sold. And that's how he became wealthy, is a small piece of a larger, you know, many franchises adds up to a lot of money. Now, that's not necessarily the case here with comedians. I'm not comparing a comic to a burger.
Sure.
But the point is that, you know, you look at ways to diversify and, have little things coming in, because you just never know. I hope to God we never go through this.
Right, right.
Because luckily I was fortunate, because I had done previous shows on like live streaming and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, so
I had
that's
a little
good.
Bit of experience. But just like you, we had to learn through the hard way to fine tune things. We had to get backdrops. And, you know, other entertainers would say, well, you're staying at home, so why are you charging more money? Because you don't know the setup that takes place. It's a lot easier to show up to a place, give you a mic, and do your jokes.
Sure.
But when you're having to do everything that you got here just in this setup here alone, I mean, it's a lot of money invested here.
Yeah.
And
well,
so,
dude, look at all the stuff I've got, and we talked about already. How many hard drives did we go through before we started?
Yes.
Let's transfer this. You should have this. Here's another thing.
Right, exactly.
All that shit costs money, man.
It does. And so as entertainers, I think you have to put value on who you are. And I think, you know, I've turned down many gigs in my career saying that I feel that the value of my show is not worth XYZ dollars. It doesn't mean I'm above that.
Right.
I mean, I would do it if I have to. But I also think there's a fine line between, you know, you work. Listen, I've been at this for 20 plus, for 30 years almost in my career. You've been doing this for a long time.
Yeah.
And there is some value there.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think people, that's one of the things that happened during COVID, was because the arts got thrown aside so by everybody. And there was this whole campaign that people said, well, now you could find another job. Why don't you look at the restaurant, be a nerd, be that, all these different things, like reinvent yourselves. Mm-hmm. And there's some legitimacy to that. I understand that. Mm-hmm. But a lot of people, like I mentioned in a previous show, people that went to Juilliard and studied their whole lives and stuff, and like, I'm not going to throw away a career.
Right.
So you have to find a way to reinvent that career to still use those skills in a different situation.
Yeah, you don't do 180 episodes accidentally.
Yeah, right.
A lot of thought process.
Yeah, exactly.
A lot of work.
Yeah, it's a ton of work. And people don't realize what goes into it. And people don't realize, like, even on a ship sometimes you'll get that. And I love the crew. They're great. They work their ass off. They're awesome.
Yep.
But a lot of the higher ups and the officers and stuff, a lot of times they'll be like, well, you're just a comedian. Yep. You don't have a real job. And you're like, well, I mean, no one knocks on your door and says, would you be a magician on a cruise ship and do a show for an hour that people will enjoy?
Right.
You know what I mean? And my thing is, I always look at it like, in a lot of ways, it's a skill. Mm-hmm. You know, if anyone could do your job, then anyone would.
Right.
You know, so it takes you years to get to that point,
right,
to fine tune it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. See, the thing about my show, you know, some people have criticized in the past just because of, you know, nature of humanity. But I don't know that my show from a magical point of view is this, oh my God, how'd that happen kind of show.
Right.
But what my show I feel is it's entertaining.
Yeah.
And that's the point. My job is not necessarily to impress the XYZ person, you know, wearing a white suit, you know, but my job is to entertain those guests to the best of my ability. Just like some people may like my show, some people may not like my show. Some people like certain comedians, some people don't like certain comics. They may like a juggler, a ventriloquist, something different. But as long as we, as artists, can find who we are. That was my biggest thing when I was 15, 17, I'm sorry. That's when I found out I need to do comedy magic.
Right.
And like that piece you saw where I was doing the stuff with the four guys on stage.
Right.
That piece used to be 17 minutes long with all the jokes. And then as time goes on, you go, I need to really trim some of the fat off of this to really get the punch home.
Sure.
And get to the point and have fun. And just like with the straitjacket, it's like, takes me probably 45 seconds or so to get out of it.
Right, right.
But the lead up to that is right. What the audience remembers.
Sure.
You know? And then the straitjacket getting out of it is just, it's like the cherry on top of the ice cream.
Said your job is to just perform to those guests to your best of your ability. This is one of the reasons I absolutely love live performance, and I think it's the most beautiful form of art. I think because there are so many different flavors out there. Mm-hmm. There's so many different.
Yes.
Look at Dice Clay, Rita Rudner. There's mm-hmm. you, Copperfield, Chris right. Angel. I mean, there's people out there that enjoy all of that.
Sure.
You know, and I've learned that. I learned it more through the podcast situation, like not so much what I'm doing now, mm-hmm. but all the different podcasts that are out there.
Right.
It's been cut into so many niche things. Mm-hmm. There's a market for a lot of things out there, and people will come to see things that they're entertained by.
Right.
You know, there are people that will see you and go, you're the greatest thing I've ever seen in my life.
Right.
And there are people that won't go to your show. Same right. thing with me. I know people that can't stand my stand-up.
Right.
And I get it. I'm like, that's cool. That's right. You know, I'm not for everybody.
Right.
And you shouldn't be, really, in a way.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You should have your own market, your own thing. But that's why live performance is so beautiful, I
right.
think.
Yeah.
It's really fantastic.
Well, the thing is with live performance, buddy, is that you're only as good as your last show.
Right? Yeah, this is nothing. That's totally
that's
true.
That's really how it boils down to in this line of work sometimes. And you have to have thick skin in this industry, obviously, because
yeah.
people will poke at you or bash you or just, you know, whatever. And it's got to be like water off a duck's back, you know.
Yep.
And so you can't take it personal. Now, there are areas of fine tuning, like what I have got. I mentioned earlier that hanging out with a lot of the comics on the ships has allowed like DJ Cooch and Kirk Smith were a couple of guys who saw my show, and we sat down for an hour and they just ripped it apart. Like, said,
yeah.
okay, and in a good way, not in a bad way, say, hey, I like this, change the pacing on this, maybe reword it this way.
Mm-hmm.
And what you saw is a culmination of me working on that in Alaska for, you know, every show. I try to do one or two things out of a different line. I'm not trying to do this whole list that they gave me, but just little by little,
yeah,
fine tuning those things and playing with it, because a joke might work now. You go, oh, that's fantastic. Or it may not. And you have to do it a couple times to see if it's going to stay or get out of there. As a matter of fact, in that bit with the four guys, again, that whole bit where the guys are having turn around and I make the comment of, you know, ladies, if you've never been to a men's restroom,
yeah, right.
It's a funny bit.
Sure.
And how that happened one time is someone in the audience, when they were all lined up, someone yelled out, it looks like they're at the urinals.
And you pick it up from the crowd. That's
yeah,
smart.
A crowd yelling.
That's cool.
So it wasn't necessarily me going. I went back and I heard the laugh on that. I said, well, what if we turn these guys around and get them closer together?
Right.
What would that be like? And it's been a part of my show you know, for years now.
Right, right.
So,
well, it's interesting you see, like, DJ Cooch, they ripped it up and he gave you a bunch of suggestions. That's the other thing with live performance that I notice that's frustrating sometimes. You can't change everything all at once. Mm-hmm. You got to change it a little bit at a time.
Correct.
Otherwise, it's hard. It's difficult to... I have one new bit I've been doing the last few weeks. I did it earlier in the week. It's this bit about the safety video before you take off on a plane. Mm-hmm. And it's this whole... There's an orange neon vest runner through the bit. Mm-hmm. There's 22 different beats in that bit. And in that, I have to do them all. I have to do them in order, and I can't drop one. Otherwise, the whole bit is shot. So I've been trying to get it down. It's a big bit. It's like, mm-hmm. you know, I think it's only, I think the whole bit itself is only 4 minutes long. But if I forget a line, the whole thing is destroyed.
Sure.
So it's been taking me forever to work on it and do it. And there have been like 3 or 4 nights I nailed it. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I got it. And I'll listen to it. But now it's a matter of just remembering it every time.
Right.
You know, because it was a hard bit to do because I didn't realize how sensitive it was to every single word in the bit. Because usually in my act, I can enamor my way through something and tell a story.
Sure.
You know, but like you said, when you make a change to your act, it's got to be baby steps in some way.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Absolutely. So
and for you, especially a guy like a magician, I've always been amazed. For you to, because you do like a trick or a piece, like the puzzle piece or whatever.
Right.
For you to do something the first time live, it's got to be daunting. Yeah, it's got to be. It's because it's a lot. And because you got to commit to the whole thing.
Sure.
You can't bail a line in. Like, the advantage I have is to go, forget it.
Yeah.
I'll do something else. But you got to ride it out.
Well, that puzzle piece, when I was first working on it, everything has to go in its place at the right time. And one of the things that I do as a cheat, which you'll never see from the audience, is that I actually have all the little pieces labeled, like 1, 2, 3,
oh, nice.
4, 5.
Oh, that's
so
cool.
I know where I'm at. Because when I started doing it, they're just a bunch of colors. And then I would get to the rearranging of it. I'm like, where goes what where? So I've learned these mnemonics in my head.
Right.
So I know that when I move some of the pieces around, that it needs to say 25 at some point. Or when I do this, it has to say, you know, 42. And I know that I'm in the right frame of mind. So I'm having to focus on that.
Right, right.
As well as speaking to the audience,
right,
and letting them know that I'm not necessarily doing math in my head. It's not math, but just making sure that everything is in its right spot. And the same thing with the rope routine, you know, doing a rope routine, there's always, I mean, you can practice stuff 100 times and do it 100 times, and there's still, it's a trick, it can go wrong.
Right.
And
right.
And so you're having to, the hardest part of magic, I think, and there's a lot of great guys, and I'm by no means an expert at manipulation, but there's guys out there like Shin Lin, who won America's Got Talent a couple years back.
Right.
The guy is phenomenal. I mean, the guy practices all the time. One of my mentors also, or not a mentor, but a guy who I learned from, was a guy named Greg Fruin out of Canada. He won with his bird act. He'd had these birds, and he would practice 8 to 10 hours a day, the same 12-minute act, over and over and over and over.
Right.
And then one of the most humble guys I've ever met, that I've had a blessing to know, get to know a little over the last couple of years, is Lance Burton.
Oh, wow. All right.
Dude, he is one of the most humble individuals you'll ever meet in your entire life. He's so gracious to everyone he comes in contact with. And he is a perfect example, him and his buddy Matt King, of how to treat human beings, you know.
Really?
I mean, the guy made million. I mean,
yeah, that's great. He's
$110
huge,
million, I believe it was, with his contract with Monte Carlo. And when he went to renew, they wanted him to cut half of his crew. And he says, I'm not doing my show without my crew.
Right.
And he walked away from renewing a contract because he cared for his people. Now,
right.
Some people argue, well, why would you do that? They all lost their income. Well, you know, it is what it is, you know. And, but Lance, if you ever get a chance to meet Lance, he's just a super gracious, kind individual.
Where's he at now? Is he doing something? Is he residency somewhere else?
No, he actually kind of semi-retired and moved back to his family's hometown in Louisville, Kentucky.
Good for him,
his
man.
Farm, working on the farm. He posts pictures on social media of him driving a tractor or planting some potatoes or whatever.
Oh, dude, sometimes I long for the simple life. You know,
yeah.
Just doing that, that's cool.
Yeah.
That's very cool.
But, you know, Lance also was one of those guys who taught me, along with my mentor, Steve, the importance of just putting money aside, you know, because as magicians, I went through a period where for like 2 years, I did not buy a magic trick.
Right.
Because it's just like, oh, I need the newest thing. I need the most updated new trick. I need to get their attention.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you look at guys like Denny Haney, who used to be in Baltimore, who had passed away a couple years ago, he would never let me buy a magic trick.
Yeah.
Until I bought a book.
Okay.
Because he wanted me to learn to read about magic and understand the showmanship aspect of magic, not just buy a trick and duplicate it. And Denny did the same act for 30 plus years or however many years he did it, but the same 30 minute set, the same thing over and over, verbatim, perfect, same costume all those years that he wore on stage. And when I was growing up in Puerto Rico, I did not have access to a lot of this stuff. Only thing is I look forward to every year when David Copperfield would do his annual Copperfield special on TV with
right.
CBS. That
right,
was
right.
what I looked forward to. And then Denny Haney, and there's Abbott's Magic in Michigan. And then there's a magic shop, actually, that's in Wichita, Kansas.
Okay.
Stevens Magic Emporium. And that's all I had access to growing up in Puerto Rico. And so learning to speak Spanish gave me the ability to do all kinds of stuff. So I worked in Puerto Rico. I worked on Channel 2 and 4 when I was young. I worked with Ricky Martin when he had long hair and doing soap operas.
Yeah, I remember him on General Hospital, yeah. I think it was.
Yeah. And he would do Menudo, was with a group. And so I got to know him and would do shows for him and their family. And so I was fortunate to be down there. So I've taken Spanish and I've been able to use it to my benefit, you know, to, and I don't mean it that way, but just the sense that it brings people who are of Hispanic speaking language to my show, and they can be entertained because now they go, oh man, he's speaking our language.
Yeah, that's cool.
He's speaking it fluently.
Yeah, yeah. I didn't know you grew up in Puerto Rico.
I did. 15 years in Puerto Rico, 3 years in Costa Rica.
Wow. Right on. How did that work out?
Well, my dad was a missionary.
Okay.
My parents were missionaries. And then my mom, she dealt with special needs, severely special needs children, like in wheelchairs at Fort Buchanan and in Puerto Rico. And then dad, he had basically established like 5 churches and then actually a Baptist college, which is still going to this day. And by MO in Puerto Rico.
Nice, right on, dude.
Yeah.
That's cool, man. I had no idea. That's cool. How did you end up in this in Wichita? You mentioned Wichita, Kansas.
That's where I would order magic tricks from.
Oh, you could order online.
Rico. Yeah. Oh, well, not right. online. It was a catalog, so you'd have to call.
Yeah, I was going to say when you were a kid, there wasn't any Amazon or online stuff. You're younger than me, I think. But
there's no Amazon when I was growing up.
No. There's none of that stuff. It was the old catalog. It's funny
yeah.
you say that.
Word.
I don't think.
I mean,
people
I'm talking
know
like
what the word
Sears,
catalog means.
I'm talking like right. Sears catalog, thick magic.
Right. So. Dude, I remember ordering stuff from catalog with a long code number. Yeah. You have to write it all out. You fill out that sheet, you know.
Yep.
And mail it in and wait. Oh,
yeah.
God,
it was like Christmas when a package would show up.
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
And I was like, oh my God. What? And then, and as a magician, you start young, you know, like, oh, I can need this. And then you'd buy it and like, I'll never use this in my show because it's
right.
just, it won't work, you know. But and so that's, I've learned to try to save money, especially when you start buying illusions. Illusions get pretty pricey, you know.
Yeah, right. I would imagine.
Yeah.
It's funny you keep bringing up, you mentioned saving money, putting money aside, which is something I didn't do and never did. And my parents never taught me. I was a single mom, raised this. She struggled, but she never taught us the value of money. And we grew up never, I mean, my brothers and I talk about this all the time because all of us we're broke and we didn't save money. I have a SAG pension from like my future
right.
and Social Security. But I have 2 teenage daughters that from early on, I've taught them checkbooks, credit cards, all through COVID, saving money, spending money. And my oldest is crazy about saving money.
Wow.
And she's looking at buying property now. She's 20. She's talking about
investing. That's fantastic.
You know, I almost cried when she told me that. We were right. driving down the road. She said, what did you think if I invested in property? I'm like,
right.
She's 19, dude.
Right.
I'm going, I can't believe that. So it's something I try to teach my kids a lot because I don't think we teach kids that enough.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think, honestly, I don't think this is good, like I don't want to get dark conspiracy. I don't think the government wants you to know about money. Like U.S. wants you to be in debt by the time you're 28, have school debt, credit card debt, so that you've got to work full time and you don't have choices to freedom. You
right.
know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
They want you to be locked down. I think that's part of it.
Yeah, you know, my dad, even as a missionary, because as a missionary, I mean, some days, as my mentor Jeff would always say, some days you eat hot dogs, some days you eat steak.
Right, yeah.
It just depends. But my dad really never taught it to me because it was never taught to him. And it was kind of ironic. I was in basically Claremont, Florida, where we used to live. And my teenage daughter at the time comes home and says, Dad, you know, you should go check out this class on finances. So I went, and it was a class by a guy named Dave Ramsey. Some people like him, some people don't. But because of Dave Ramsey, I got out of debt.
And yeah.
because my 15-year-old daughter said, Dad, you should check this out.
Right.
Well, she's now grown and married. But my third daughter, I have 4 girls,
okay.
and I did say 4, so if you're watching, you can pray for me now.
Dude, I feel for you. I got 2.
So,
I'm like,
but my third daughter just bought her first car, paid cash for it, and is 19 years old.
Oh, good for her.
She bought a 2019 Jeep
Yeah.
So, you know, that's a $20,000-$30,000 car, but she's worked hard.
Yeah.
Because I've been on her since she was 10 years old about the value of putting money aside, you know. And then I think the other thing, too, is I try to teach my kids to be good to humanity, because there's a lot of people. We talked about the crew here, you know. Even when we were in the different ports that we went to, it's just supporting the local people, because you saw it, Belize.
Dude, what a great day in Cozumel, man. They were so happy to see us there.
Absolutely happy to see us. And I've taught my kids, you know, give. It's important to give. You don't have to give everything, but I think there's a principle in life that if you give, you're going to get. You know, you don't give to get, but when you do give, I expect to receive at some point a blessing of some kind.
Well, it's kind of like a keep pay it forward, move it forward thing.
Sure.
You know what I mean? I'm a big believer in that too. Like absolutely. I know when I'm in LA, there's a lot of times I'll buy food for people, homeless. I'll just do things. But like in Cozumel, this is funny, but I bought one burlap bear backpack, like a burlap backpack, and I overpaid for it, and I know I did, because I bought them. I bought this stuff before, and I go, how much? She's like, 25, and I go, well, I'll give you 20, but I could have got it for 10, you know. But I'm like, dude, and I tipped the mariachi guys $20 because I was taping them, you know.
Right.
So I'm like, usually in Cozumel, there's usually 8 ships in there, and then that port is crazy and it's packed with people.
Right. I think the pay it forward boss is, I don't know why I called you boss, but Lenny, it's a habit to call people boss,
that's,
I guess.
All right. It's better than what my daughters call me.
That's right. I think paying it forward is so huge. I mean, this could be coincidence. You call it what you want, but sometimes I believe sometimes in a higher powers. I believe that, you know, some people may not, and that's okay. Everybody's entitled to believe, but how I was raised, obviously, in the background with my parents, I believe the importance of giving. And this is maybe coincidence or not, but I something told me to take care of my stage techs this cruise after the show.
Right.
And after that, something told me, there was one of the employees who I was talking to that just seemed like hadn't been off the ship for like 5 months,
right,
almost, or however long she's been here. And something told me to just give her something. And right. I did. No sooner. And sometimes it's human nature, like, you know, I don't want, like, I only got $20 in my pocket or whatever the case is. And sometimes I feel if you just give it, just let it go, for to speak. So I'd say this, I get back to my cabin. I get an email from Carnival offering me another gig that pays me 10 fold,
yeah, right,
100 fold what I just did.
Yeah.
Coincidence, possibly,
yeah, right,
but I like to think not.
Yeah, I'm with you on the same. I'm the same way. I mean, I also agree with, I don't do it to get stuff. You just keep. Also, I just feel better, man. You
yeah,
know, part
absolutely.
Of it is because I grew up, you know, I mean, we were completely poor growing up, but my mom struggled with 5 boys, sure, and we didn't have a lot. And as we've grown up, we've had a lot of curveballs, and my brothers are going through some stuff. And so I kind of come from a background where I know my mom needed help. My mom definitely needed help. Mm-hmm. And if she didn't get it, I don't know if I'd be here right now.
Right.
I don't know if we'd be together as a family. I mean, she was lucky enough to have family step up, and she let her brother stay here for a while, her brother stay here. And there were different things that she got that helped her.
Right.
And she had to fight to get where she was. So she eventually got to a good place. But everybody needs help sometimes. And there's nothing wrong with doing the right thing. I tell my daughters, I'm like, just do the right thing. There's nothing wrong with doing the right thing.
I think sometimes as humans, if we hear that little voice in our head, you know, it says do something, as human nature, we want to fight it. But I think as I get older in life, and that's where a lot of that puzzle piece message comes into play there, because my mom did truly tell me those things. It's not a made up story.
Right.
The hardest part about that particular routine is being able to get through the dialogue without getting emotional, because I know my mom is on the screen behind me.
Yeah, right.
It doesn't matter how long they've been gone.
Yeah.
It still elicits emotions of feelings. I was performing this on the one of the Carnival Miracle ships, and I heard a lady off to my left side yell out or whisper, but it was loud at that moment because it's kind of quiet. Everybody's just listening during that part of my show. She goes, "That's his mom." And when she said that, it immediately triggered, like, I could feel it coming on.
Right.
And I'm glad I was going to a blackout at that point, because it gave me a second, 3 seconds to just kind of compose myself. Because when we talk, well, here's the thing, it's come out. A lot of comics talk about personal life stories. That's where your comedy comes from a lot of times. And I think sometimes when we put ourselves out there and put our emotions out there as far as life, I think that humanizes us.
Yeah.
And so someone may not like your style of comedy or magic, whatever it is, but when you get to a piece like that, it's the only piece of my show that changes the entire dynamics, because it's all about comedy. Ha, ha, ha.
Right.
Let's have fun. Let's enjoy this. And that's the one moment that allows me to give a message and says, listen, we need to learn to love each other. You know, we've all been hurt from the past. We've all had things happen to us. We've had people try to undercut us, or people try to push us out, or talk bad about us. And if we can just let that stuff go, I think karma is karma, you know, and I think what goes around comes around. And I just think if we learn to be nice to other people and just help each other out, that's all we can do. And COVID taught us all that. I think, at least me, I can't speak for everybody else, but it taught me the value of enjoying people and spending time with those who you love, because you just never know. I mean, I have had several friends who are no longer here because of COVID.
Yeah.
You know, people who you'd pick up the phone, what's up, how you doing, let's get together, and they're not there now. And so, you know, as much as we don't like wearing those masks or whatever, but, you know, it is what it is. But I'm just glad that we're back to work again, you know.
Yeah, right.
Hopefully we can keep that going. And but magic and comedy is a way to help people heal. People need comedy. I don't know about you, but when I came on my very first ship, people were so excited to be back out.
Yeah, cruising again. They're still kind of excited.
They are.
They're still, because most of the people we're seeing, it's their first cruise.
Yes.
Like, we've been out here for a couple of months or weeks or whatever it is we've been doing. Almost everybody we see is their first cruise back.
Yes.
90% of the people. There's a few that have done a couple, but and everybody's so excited to be here and so positive. And I think I think something happened through COVID too. And you mentioned entertainers sometimes it's a tendency to knock each other down, or you know, it's a competition. And I think COVID brought us together more. I think more entertainers, especially entertainers, because like you said, every single one of us lost everything in a blink. You know, and most of us are like, well, it'll be back. And then 8 months later, we're like, oh my God, it's not back yet.
Right.
You know, and I don't know if you're like me, I was like already like, all right, well, what else can I do? I was at a point where it's time to figure out. I got kids, man. So I was going to go back in the restaurant business. You're just trying to figure out ways to make money.
Sure.
So I think as we came back, I think a lot of us are so grateful to be back and performing again, that more entertainers are supportive of each other than they were ever before.
I agree.
And I think when people came back, I live in LA, and even though it's a liberal state, as we started to open up and people came back, there was a lot of anger and bitterness that was hanging over. But I think a lot of that has to do with the political side of it.
Sure. There's a lot of political stuff going
on. Yeah. But I think as time went by, people began to open up and be more happy and grateful to be back and out.
Right.
And learn to adjust. Like you said, the mask thing. Like, if I got to wear a mask to cruise and work, I guess I'll wear a mask to cruise and work. Things happened, you know, stuff. I mentioned World War II. Worlds changed. The planet changes. All kinds of stuff happens where you have to adapt and go, okay, well, this is the new normal.
Right.
But how can I adapt and make it the best for me and the people around me?
Correct. And the only way to do that is to surround yourself with people who are being successful in that realm. Like you mentioned, one of the other comics who's done very well. He figured out a way to do corporate stuff.
Yeah.
You know? I know there's great magicians. Costa Kimlet's one of out of Orlando. He's a corporate guy, and he learned how to. He didn't lose money. You know,
That's great.
There's guys like Justino Zoppi, who was a celebrity illusionist for many cruise lines like Disney, Royal Caribbean, Celebrity, during this, he made a decision to stay home with his daughter. He and I talked. He says, I'm going to take 3 years off. And now he works for a BMW dealership, and he's probably like the top guy of that dealership because of his background with video stuff and understanding that line. So when someone walks in to buy a car from him, it's not like the regular salesperson goes, here's my card. This guy is like a presentation. It's like, when do I buy the car?
Yeah.
Kind of thing. And so he's done so well with that, and he and his wife have done great, you know. And so I just think, you know, for long term, if anybody's watching this, I really highly, strongly encourage entertainers to try to find a way to invest. Like, you know, get yourself a CPA, find someone who can help you with stocks, you know, and especially if you're a younger comic or someone younger starting off, you know, and even it doesn't matter your age, just do something for your future, because God forbid, if we go through this again, what will you be doing?
Right.
You know?
Right. Well, you also mentioned something earlier too, where you were talking about, I keep going back to diversifying and especially young comics, and you're only as good as your last show. Mm-hmm. Those words rang really true with me maybe about 6 years ago, where I was on ships and I was working. Mm-hmm. And I was good. I was happy on ships. Mm-hmm. But I was only getting paid for my live performance. That's all I was getting money-wise, monetary-wise. Mm-hmm. As long as I was on stage, I was making money.
Right.
So diversifying, another thing young performers need to learn now, and like I try to teach my daughter, is you need to have multiple sources of income coming in from what you're doing. So when I started this whole life, the YouTube shows and stuff, I have a YouTube platform. I'm not monetized on YouTube, but I have a monetization platform on my website that can continue to generate money. Correct. It does on a daily basis because content will stay online at all times. So even, and I've even thought this far ahead, if I pass away and that stuff stays up, that money keeps coming in, I can go to my kids.
Right.
I mean, that's the only legacy kind of that I've, it might be late in the game for me to figure that out, but I have enough content that if you, the whole concept of my stuff is you watch something and if you like it, pay 10 bucks for it.
Right.
And enough people pay it, then enough people got money coming in. But the key is, as a live performer, I'm going off now. It's like it's my show. Sorry.
No, this is your show.
I learned it a lot when I started doing shifts because I stopped acting and I was doing a lot of TV and film before, had a lot of residuals coming in. Well, the more you're gone, the more those residuals disappear and you're only as good as your last show. So if you don't find a way to make money off your content while you're not performing, you're going to be in trouble because there's going to be a day like COVID comes when you're not performing.
Well, there's a I told you, mentioned my two of main mentors I had in my career, Jeff O'Lear. He and his wife ran a very, very successful business called The Brain Show. And The Brain Show is basically an interactive game show on steroids, basically for school assembly shows, and corporate clients and professional football teams have used this.
Okay.
Every year we perform this show with the billionaires of the world. And in Idaho, Sun Valley, Idaho, every year they have all the billionaires get together and they decide what's going to be happening with the money. So I've met all the big people in this world that make a lot, that are very, very wealthy people, like the Kind candy bar guy, all the Apple computer guys, the Microsoft people.
Wow.
I met Oprah. I've met, you know, Copperfield, and all these people come to get together. But the point is, what I'm getting at is that Jeff and Beverly, we would perform for 500,000 school children a year, and they would hire me to come in and host the show throughout the year sometimes when they got really super busy. And so COVID hit, well, school shut down.
Sure.
There's no more, that income just stopped.
Yeah.
So what Jeff and I did, we got together and we brainstormed and we created a virtual brain show that's 30 minutes long.
Right.
That the schools have now from kindergarten all the way to eighth grade, that they can now purchase and they can play with their kids and their students at home, or even if they're in the classrooms on the computers and all that stuff. So they had to learn to adapt, because when you think about all the equipment, like a show that they have probably in equipment alone per show is like probably $40,000 to $60,000 in computer gears. Their company is one of the companies who also created those little clickers you see on Jeopardy.
So oh, really?
It's called the lockout system. So when people buzz and
it's
opened up,
in.
They can't buzz in.
Okay.
And it's an all computerized system.
Right.
And they had to switch from like LEDs to dot matrix systems. But when COVID hit, they had to switch to a totally different platform. So now I get emails every day almost from people goes, oh, we ordered it. So to your point about the legacy, we created something once.
Right.
And now every time someone clicks on it, you know, it's XYZ dollars that they get paid every time they download that or pay for it. And it's, you know, password protected, so it can't be, you know, per se distributed illegally,
right,
or, which people can still figure out, obviously, as you know. But the point is, they had to adjust. And as entertainers, if you're only like, even as an agent, even if the cruise ship, what I do, booking people, entertainment shuts down, that's all
gone. You use that source of income too,
right? So you have to have, like you said to your daughters, you got to have more than one egg in a basket, because not that egg can crack, and then what do you do?
Right, then you're screwed.
Yep.
Yeah, and I think COVID taught that to a lot of different people.
Yes.
And it really, it also gave people the tools to do it.
Right.
They look at things like Zoom, and it also, one of the things I thought it did that was really good, it taught people I think quality of life became to be a very important thing during COVID. It taught people who had a job, a corporate job that worked it for whatever, a lot of them didn't go back. They were like, I don't have to go back to that office.
Right.
I can work from home. I can find another job. Mm-hmm. I've already created this thing. And that's why they're having so many, one of the reasons they're having problems hiring people on all different levels at different places. Because when they first opened up again, certain companies tried to push this back to the office thing.
Right.
And people were like, I'm not coming back to the office.
Right.
Whether it was a safety issue or not.
Right.
I think everybody learns that you have more options in life than you do. Because if you would have told everyone a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, hey, we're going to shut down for a year and there's going to be no cruise ships, you can't go outside and the whole world's going to change, I think everybody would have freaked. You know what I mean? If you gave them, you know, so it was baby steps all the way through. It was like, well, till June, then till April, and then wear a mask for now and this. You know, but if you'd have told people, hey, 2 years, we're not going to do anything.
Well, you look at how life changes. Back in 1999, everybody thought the world was going to come to a collapse with the dot.
Y2K, right?
Y2K. Yeah. And if you look at back in, 2000, I think it was, Apple stock was $1.17.
Wow.
Amazon stock
was
under $2.
Yeah, right.
So imagine what would have happened to all of us as entertainers, if we had bought. You never know what's going to happen, obviously, but imagine what would where we would be at financially if we had just invested in stuff. So that just shows you in 20 years, things can change like that.
Yeah.
And it just seems like the other day I was holding my first child.
Yeah.
And now she's married. And my youngest now is 17, so, I mean, time goes by in a blink of an eye. And I think COVID has taught us the value of our time with our family, you know, and today's generation, you know, who would have thought, 20 years later, you know, that cell phones, I mean, my kids know more about cell phones. Like if I have a problem, that's who I go to.
Sure. 100%.
Because that's their life. And so as entertainers, how do we get kids? One of the biggest.
Yeah, I just have to take the abuse.
Right. Exactly.
Because they're really dad. Okay, dad. It's a lot of boomer. I'm like, I got it. Dude, just show me to download the picture.
You know, it's a bad time when you're sitting at the table and your daughter texts you, pass you the ketchup. Something's got to stop. That's messed up.
All right. This is ridiculous.
Yeah. Like, we need to put our phones down. And I think that's the other thing with family time, you know, is that for people who might be watching, who have families and stuff like that, is, you know, try to spend time with their families, because you just never know, you know. And so in my house, dinner time, phones are done. And for me as a business owner, because, you know, I'm always checking my phone and making sure everything's okay. Yeah. That's a hard thing to do, but I'm telling you right now, that pays off in the long run for everything, because it allows you to connect with your family again. And like for this show, one of the shows, I don't know if it was the first or second show that I did on this ship. The girl is a teenage girl, and teenagers are very hard to impress.
Yes.
I saw them yesterday, and they came up to me and goes, I really enjoyed the show, and thank you so much, and I really appreciate it. For people who are in technology, that means the world to me, because they are hard to impress, you know?
Right, yeah.
And you know the feeling. Like when someone comes up and goes, I laughed, you made me feel good. And one of the things in magic that I've done, this has always been my mentality. Before every show, I have this little ritual that I kind of do, is that I kind of just say a prayer that I'll be given the words to be able to entertain these people, and that they'll be happy and inspired. And so in my head, life is going to happen no matter what. When they walk into that theater, they're still going to be bills when they get back home.
Yeah.
When they walk into that theater, they're still going to have they may have come from having an argument with their wife, you know, I wanted to do this, or their kids. My goal as an entertainer is for 45 minutes, I want to take you into a fourth dimension. Come into my world. Let's laugh. Let's have fun. Because after my show's over, that stuff's still going to be there.
Mm-hmm.
But for the next 45 minutes, my goal is to let them forget about that and get into that moment of laughing, having a good time. Because my mom, she just said, son, if you can learn to laugh, laugh at life, have fun. Because life is still gonna happen.
Yeah.
So you have options. You can get upset about it. And we do, we're gonna get upset, it's gonna happen. But if we can get past that as quickly as possible, then we can get more, and it's healthier for us. You know, we talk about working out, you know, one of the challenges of working on a ship is they have food everywhere, you know, and you have to kind of pace yourself, you know, and doing like a cleanse or, you know, a modified fasting of some kind, because if not, we'll grow, I mean, we'll get pretty big if we're not
careful. Yeah, no, right, you know? I've gotten,
And so I like working on ships because it makes me focus. Like I got up this morning and worked out for close to an hour. So it's, you know, it's that commitment. So just like committing to your health, you have to commit to the entertainment field.
Right.
And you have to be willing to change and adapt, as you've pointed out several times, because like we said, you're only good as your last show.
Right.
Change is going to happen. It's how you handle that change.
Yeah, thank you. That's the biggest thing I try to teach my daughters is – it's how you handle things. It's adversity. It's what happens. Like my mom didn't come out and teach that verbally to me, but like I had mentioned, we'd grown up struggling a little bit, but my mom had a great sense of humor. Mm-hmm. My mom turned me on to, she was a huge fan of Red Fox and Bob Newhart. She loved Flip Wilson, but she listened to comedy albums all the time. So, and she would make fun of, you know, we're, oh, no cable this month or whatever. I mean, the shitty situations or the tough situations we went through, right, she just made fun of. And right, that's obviously where I got my sense of humor, and all my brothers did.
Right.
Was you look at, and so my thing is, and I went to also, and this is after my divorce, I went through a ton of therapy, and I really learned and embraced the fact that life's going to happen no matter what. So you have two choices. You can be miserable about it and complain, right, or you can just deal with it and move on.
Right. You know? Well, I was married for 23 years, and I did go through a similar divorce situation. And, you know, things happen for whatever reason they do. And one of the things that my counselor had told me, because when you go through a divorce sometimes, especially at the ages where my kids were, there can be a lot of just putting down of people, you know, yeah, oh, your dad this or your mom that, and you have to be really careful not to do that. And it's not easy because we're human. We have our egos. And what the counselor, he says, Glenn, you got to learn to love your kids from a distance sometimes.
Yeah.
And that was the biggest note for me. And that's human nature. And now I have a great relationship with all my girls again, and it's awesome. And we get to hang out. And now I'm a grandfather. I have three grandkids.
Right. That's great.
And having my first granddaughter, she was born this past June prematurely. 1 pound, 6 ounces, and now she weighs 8 pounds. So that's been a blessing. And got a hold of her just last week because I've been gone traveling so much. Before I came here, I held her for the first time, and I was like, oh my God, I forgot how tiny these things are.
Right.
I was
you get scared again, right? You're like, oh, don't bump into me.
Yeah,
don't
exactly.
bump into me. Trying to concentrate.
Yes.
Well, another thing my counselor told me, or my therapist told me the same thing early on. Because one thing I never did was I never bashed my ex in my act. It was really important for me not to do that. And one of the reasons he taught me, he put it this way. He's like, you got to remember, he goes, your daughters look at you. Your kids look at you.
Sure.
And they'll learn from you, and they pay attention to what you do. So I've never really badmouthed my exes in front of my kids. But one thing was, it was the opposite with my ex who did. And to this day, it really frustrates my daughters so much to the point where they get angry at her.
Right.
But when your kids are growing up, they see. I mean, they're looking at you for examples.
Sure.
So if you treat your ex with disrespect, or anyone for that matter with disrespect, your children, that's where hate is learned. That's where that muscle is learned to kids.
Sure.
Is
and
by
that's
example.
What I talk about in that show, about people who've hurt you or hatred of what you see going on in the world around you. And hate can come from different points, whether it's racial tension, whether it's political tension.
Sure.
And I think that's one of the biggest things. That's one of the biggest things that COVID has taught me, is that how divided sometimes people are when it comes to the entertainers, as far as their political views and posting that stuff on social media and being angry at someone who's been your friend for 20 years, but because they don't exactly agree with you politically, now let's be enemies and I'm going to delete you and screw you. What's that teaching our society? What's that teaching our kids?
Right.
It's teaching us that I got to pick a side.
Yeah.
Hey, there is no side, man. We're all the same color when you cut us. You know what
I'm saying? Right.
We're all bleed red or purple, whatever you call it. But the point is that we got to do the better at teaching our kids this. And listen, like you, I grew up, Spam?
I love Spam.
I
just introduced my daughter to it a few weeks ago. Yeah.
And Cheese Whiz sandwiches. That was our grilled cheese sandwiches, you know? And
it's still good, too. Spam's still good.
I'm so like, good.
I know it's terrible for you.
I know.
But I had it. I'm like, oh my God, I forgot how good this really tastes.
Yes, especially when it's fried.
Yeah, you know, we fried it. We did it. And my daughter's like, oh my God, this is delicious. I go, I know, right? I'm like, it's so good.
So that and peanut butter. So you learn to, again, it's adapting. And I think it's just being grateful where we're at. So I'm as fortunate. I feel humbled and grateful that I've been able to work, because I've had a chance to work for quite a few cruise lines, you know, and starting back up, you know. So I'm just glad to be here, glad to be working, doing what I is. When I walk out on stage, as I'm probably, you still feel the same way. That first time, you might be a little nervous because you're like, let's see how this goes. It's been a while.
I might have forgot
how to be funny.
Yeah.
But once you get through that first one, you just take a deep breath. You go, man, this is why I do what I do.
Yeah.
And I'm so happy, and I'm just happy to hear people laugh.
Yeah, it was a weird recharge and reboot for everybody. You know what I mean? When you were off for that long, like I did a little bit of shows here and there, you know, during the breakdown, the shutdown.
Mm-hmm.
But when I went, my longest gap, I think, was from October to February for something live. And it was like a recharge. It was like just plugging back in and like, oh, yeah, this is, I forgot how cool this is.
Yo, I mean, I don't know about you, but like I had to go back and watch some of my old recorded videos so I could remember some of the scripting.
I listened to my album. I had to download my album from iTunes.
You had to buy your own album.
Well, there was a bit I forgot. I'm like, how does that bit go? So I literally was on the road. I went, I gotta download it. So I listened to it on the album because there was a bunch of, because I tape stuff all the time anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
So I was constantly listening to old tapes going, oh, that's right. Oh, that's right.
Apple's like, yeah, you do realize you produced this and you just paid us for it.
No. Yeah, well, it's worth it. Trust me. One thing I want to mention before we go, I wanted to bring up earlier, I forgot, we kind of dabbled around it. I work really hard with my stand up and it's easier because I have teenage daughters to, again, in a way, diversify, but keep my act fresh so it's interesting to younger people. Like you mentioned, the teenager that enjoyed your show. It's so hard to stay in that mode where young people still appreciate your show. I did one of the greatest, this is the best compliment I ever got, well, maybe ever, really. I played Chicago in July. I'm from Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And my cousin came out. It's actually my cousin's daughter. She's 22. She brought a bunch of friends to the show downtown. And they came up after, and they raved about the show. They loved it, and they were screaming, and, you know, and I felt so good. I'm like, oh, man, these kids are 22, and they enjoyed the whole show.
Right.
So I work really hard, and the daughters help, because I write about them, and I write, they, you know, I get ideas from them all the time. Mm-hmm. So one of the things you do in your show, you brought the video aspect of it on there, which is a great way to bridge the gap with that younger generation. We talked about the attention span and the quick clips that you have before you start the show, the 9-minute video.
Right.
It's a brilliant idea. It's a great way to bring your full show and make it entertaining for that 17-year-old. That's why it works for her.
I started doing that back in 2010. I started working shifts in 2009. And in 2010, I love editing. I love that process. I know I've had several people say, Glenn, let someone else take care of that because that's time out of your schedule. And I understand that, but I'm a creative guy and I like to go in there. And that video you saw has gone through a series of fine tunings.
Sure.
You know? And it constantly has to change because things change in our society.
That's the thing with technology especially, and as fast as it changes now, like my jokes, I got to drop references. You got to update it constantly.
Right. And so I've created files that I know that this is the newer version. It's updated. And if I got to, you know, go in the, I have spots where I can, you know, edit that out, but I've learned all. I self-taught myself to be, here's the thing. When I did my first promo video, it cost me $1,700 for a minute and a half.
Wow.
And at that point, I'm like, I need to learn how to do this.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
That was like back in early 2004.
Right.
So I started learning how to do that. And then in 2006, 7, and 8, I won a Florida State Magician of the Year doing a bird act that I did, producing a bunch of live animals. That was the only serious piece. And my staff, my crew, the girls are like, we don't like it when you do that because you get so stressed out. I don't think I'm stressed out. I just particular about how I want it to be done. So call it what you want to call it. But once it is over, they're like, yeah, you're a totally different person once you got through your bird act, you know? And so that was funny. But yes, I think video technology, because I can go do that same show in front of a black curtain and people will still have a good time. But when I can do that show and there's visual stuff, they are being entertained. Now to them, I come across as one of their big production shows.
Right, of course. Yeah.
And it's just me working out of a Pelican Air carry-on case. My entire show and my clothes fit in that.
Right. So yeah, that's great.
For my show clothes, that is, not the regular clothes, but so if they lose everything, I can at least walk on stage.
Yeah, that's
and
smart
I can
move,
still
brother.
Do my show. And I learned that from Paul Romhaney years ago, to have an emergency show in your backpack.
Right.
Because you just never know. And so I actually have notes where I've written stuff out that if they lose something, where I can get it on a ship, what could I use? Like if they lost that pole.
Yeah.
That pole, a guy, Cody Fisher helped me find that. I used to have this long pole. It weighed like 3.5 pounds. And I found this pole because it's what guys who lay cable on ceilings, it's what they use to pull it.
Right.
So I'm like, well, what if I put a bucket on the end of this thing?
Right.
It'd be fun. And the thing just was a monstrosity. But then he taught me, he goes, well, if you get this, he gave me something where you, so when you're golfing, if you go in the water, it's like a little hole and you just scoop it out, the golf ball.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So he goes, just take a pin, take that out, and then put a ring through it and then put the bucket on that. And so now everything just fits into my case, like it's easy peasy.
Yeah, you MacGyver it together. Man, last week, Sideshow Bert was here, or Phil Eaton, I don't know if you know him.
Uh-huh.
But he forgot something he needed for, he's a juggler.
Uh-huh.
And he's got a GoPro that he's got an extension that he uses to do a trick, and he forgot it. So he made it out of a coffee cup. He got a coffee cup and he wrote down how to do it. He was just a genius. I can't believe, but it's the same exact thing. You just figure out a way to make it work. And it's such a good advice too, by the way. Like I do that. Like I don't have a lot of stuff to bring with me as far as doing the show, but I always bring in my backpack, I have a set of show clothes, one set of show clothes, and my notebook, my comedy notebooks, so that if they lose all my clothes and stuff, I can at least perform for the week. You know what I mean? At least I can go up on stage.
So
do a
when
show.
I travel with shoes that I can wear on stage. It's the only time I typically wear them is traveling at the airports back and forth. So like even now, they will go back in my suitcase, back packed. You know, I mean, I wear them. They don't go packed, so I wear them at all times, going and coming. And so I think for comics out there or anybody who's in the entertainment industry, you should always look at ways to fine tune. And here's the biggest tip I will give anybody in the entertainment industry. Videotape every single show. Yeah. And here's why. Two reasons. Number one, we live in a society where people want to sue people. You got proof. That's number one.
Yeah.
Number two, it allows you to go back. If something funny happens in the show, you may not remember it, but you can review it. The worst thing you can do is format the card and delete it. No big deal. You're done. You know. But a lot of my shows, I'll give you a perfect example. I was performing on the Disney cruise ship one time, and I did a welcome aboard show. I had to do like a 15-minute set with them. And the first show, this kid comes up on stage, and I do a trick with this kid. And he was so nervous, he farted. He passed gas on stage in front of 1,000 people. Now, they couldn't hear him, but I could smell him.
Right, okay.
You know what I'm saying? And I was like, whoa, this is right. But I didn't acknowledge anything like that. So he went back to the seat. Second show, I show up. There was a guy doing sign language. And when the kid came up on stage, it triggered my experience. And I saw that guy at the same time. So when this kid sat down, I had a question for him. I'm like, excuse me, sir, I don't mean to run. So I acknowledged him. Everybody cheered for him. He was signing for a family who was there of 5 people.
Right.
And I said, I have a curious question. How do you say fart in sign language?
Okay.
And so he...
Yeah.
And so for the rest of the cruise, I became known as, you walk past people, I said, that's what's going to happen when you go to the buffet, folks. And so everybody was doing this.
Yeah, yeah.
And ever since then, anytime I have a guy in the audience signing or a female, I bring it up.
Right.
Because it was a funny bit that happened by chance.
Sure, yeah, right.
And when I was on The Miracle a couple weeks ago, that happened. And the couple came up to me. The lady, she was like, I'm like, what's she saying? She goes, she's crying. She's laughing so hard about your show and the whole thing about farting. And she gave me a hug. She hugged me like 3 times.
Right.
But what I did is I made that person feel special at that moment in time. And they felt like the show wasn't even for the 1,000 people sitting in the theater. They felt that show was for them.
Yeah.
And that's as entertainers, you got to find stuff. And that's why I think videotaping is so important.
Well, that's just, well, connecting with the audience is significant right there. I mean, that's huge. Anytime you connect with any individual, that's why most of my stand-up is so personalized. It tells stories about my mom and growing up. So people look at it and go, oh, yeah, I connect with that. I understand. Right. Yeah.
And here's the thing, just so we're clear, I am not a stand-up comic. What you do, Lenny, and what all these other guys do, I tip my hats off to you guys, because to be able to sit down and write out jokes and material and crowd work.
Yeah.
You know, one of the comedians, Eddie, he was like, I'm going to come to your show and harass you. I'm like, well, if you do, I might cry because I don't have a comeback. You know, I'll be honest with you. So.
That would be horrible.
We're going to drink and come and sit in the front row. I'm like, I got no comeback.
Show us a trick.
Yeah, exactly. Come on, please leave. No, so what you guys do, I always tip my hats off to stand-up comics, especially having to have an hour and a half to 2 hours of material and maybe even more at times so that people want to hear you again. Because they're coming back to see your show, and you got to have a clean show and you got to have an adult show. So I respect you guys immensely. That's not what I do. I just do comedy. I have kind of a scripting that I can go off a little bit, but then it just brings me back to the road that I need to be on to get through the show. And so, you know, if there's other guys out there watching, there's a couple things I could quickly recommend as, you know, like I control most of my show from my pocket.
Right.
Yeah. I have a controller. There's a Pro Mystic is one of them. And then Audio Ape is another one that people could look at buying and purchasing. And, you know, there might be some links in, you know, this video. They can check it out if they want. And I don't make a dime off of that. It's just what I use.
Yeah, sure.
You know, it packs in a little box like this. I can use it on my iPhone or I can use it on an Android now.
Yeah.
Or you can use it on an iPad, anything. And you can just get your whole show there and you're ready to go. I use Go Button, which is an app that I download. I think it's like $100. And I think a lot of times entertainers don't want to invest in their businesses. And also, I think that's the point. You got to invest in yourself. You got to invest so that when I come on a ship, my goal is I want the technician who's running my show to go, that was the easiest guy to deal with.
Right. Yeah.
He's nice. He's kind.
Yeah.
Easy peasy.
He's got everything set up. So, you know, it's all formatted.
Cue sheets for him. Yeah, right. You know, and but you brought up the video aspect. So that's kind of changed a little bit. I use QLab and stuff like that, which is a program people can purchase. And
that's cool. They use all the stuff I've never even heard of. You know what I mean? That's amazing. That's great. I love to hear that.
Been doing it for a long time, you know, and you're always looking at ways, how do I make it better? How do I make my travel easier? You know, that was one of the things. When I started working ships, I would look at a comedian, I'm like, man, alive. All they have is a backpack and a carry-on.
Yeah.
Especially when you were doing the back-to-backs. And right, as a magician, I'm lugging three things. And I'm like, so I learned to really condense that down to really small. And to this day, even this cruise alone, I made notes of what I need to not bring or what I to make it even better. It's constantly that fine-tuning process. And eventually, you get it right.
Well, that's kind of the fun thing about it, though. Like, when I had mentioned, I wasn't doing any of this stuff before COVID.
Right.
No taping, no recording, no nothing. So when I bought stuff during COVID, I bought it with the mindset of, we're going to go back out and I want to be able to travel with this. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, oh, it's like, I got an audio interface and someone said, you should get this other one. It's bigger. I go, no, this is perfect. It's two channels, whatever. Right. So I try to keep it small and whatever. And even now there's stuff I don't need this. I don't need that. I got a green screen with me. I'm like, I don't really need that. You know, although I'm going to use it today for some other stuff.
Right.
But there's a list of other things I don't need. I'm like, I can get rid of this. The goal is, I don't know if I can get back to backpack carry on. I don't know if I can get that small anymore. But I'm going to try. You know what I mean? I'm going to try to get close. So we'll see what happens. But
Well, one of the things we were talking about is when I record my shows, we were talking about before we started recording today, is that I use the Rode Go Wireless. And basically, URSA, which is called URSA, U-R-S-A, they sell this little strap that you can go around underneath your shirt. And if you're female, just goes right below your breast, your breast, basically. And you can
It would be my breast too. I would need to go roll my breast.
Yeah. More push-ups then. Once again, more push-ups here. You put the mic underneath your shirt.
Yeah.
And it's got a little adapter, so you're not getting that.
Yeah, I was going to ask. There's no rub or none of that.
Not with that. Not with the URSA. There's not.
See, that's.
Here's where I learned that from. I didn't learn that, but when I was on the Miracle or the Vista, the very first coming back sailing, I was with a comedian, Tim Young.
Yeah. I know Tim Young.
Tim records all of his shows.
I love Tim,
I said, he had tape. He uses tape. Well, if I had tape on my chest, it would hurt because I have hair.
Yeah, and, right.
Well, I'm not doing that. And Tim is a super nice guy. And I just asked him, I said, hey, what are you doing? And so he told me. So then I started doing some research. And I found this URSA, which is what opera or singers on Broadway is what every cast member uses here.
Really?
They wear these. Theirs are thicker. They wear backpacks. So anyways, the little microphone basically goes in the back belt loop. It comes here and it goes straight to my camera. So I get clean audio to all my videos when I record that. So those are little, and that was like, I think that was a total investment of maybe $200 for that.
I could record my stand-up shows that way then, right?
Absolutely. You can record your stand-up. You could even do a podcast with them like this. You wouldn't even have to use all this stuff, possibly.
Right.
Now, you got XLRs and stuff like that. And so, I have a Sennheiser XLR. That's a $900 microphone that I used back when I'm in Florida. As a matter of fact, I started using them on the ships here, but then I found this Go Wireless. You saw it.
Yeah.
It's in a little box.
Yeah.
That whole thing does exactly the same thing as the other one does. The other one's more expensive. It's more higher end. But
dude, you're going to have to give me I'm going to have to write that down or get that information from you. I would love to do that because then I would eliminate carrying the Shure 58s and cords and all this other stuff.
You can still carry it, but you don't have to carry the cable because it's a wireless connector that just goes to your...
That's even better.
So it just clips around the back of that microphone.
Good.
So you could have two microphones like that. Now, granted, you'd be spending some money for that, although they would sell you an extra one that would pair up with the same one so you're getting the different line feeds, per se. But
if I could
pull
the sound right to the camera, then I could just pull the audio off the camera through the mix.
But I'm going to be honest with you. The Sennheisers are fantastic, $900. But I'm telling you, there's no much difference than the Go Wireless, which was $200.
Really?
Yeah. And you would totally eliminate all this stuff. You don't even need the interface at that point because it just goes straight to the camera, plugs into, to your computer.
Yeah, because also, and then I mix it into the software program. Oh my God, that's brilliant.
I tell you what, if there's for people who are out watching this, I recommend go to YouTube and go to a company called Think Media.
You turned me on that the other day. I subscribed.
Sean Cannell is his group and organization is probably, and I don't make a dime for saying this. This is just me talking just to help people out.
Right.
They have, if you're wanting to go, hey, I want to do a podcast, how do I do it? Hey, I want to try to do some live tube videos for Instagram or YouTube or all these other things. What's the best equipment to get? they will tell you everything that you need to get in there. And it's basically, it's a resource. It's like the encyclopedia, which if you don't know what encyclopedia is, most people don't. It was the old Google.
Yeah. So, in hard form.
Yeah.
In
just like people who have AOL.com.
Yeah.
AOL emails. It still blows my mind.
I know. I got a couple of friends like that.
But not that it matters if they have that.
Yeah.
But the point is that that's a source. B&H Photo Hobby is a great place where you can buy it. You can go online and look at stuff where you can buy it online on Amazon. I mean, I live in Florida. I can order something at night and it's at my doorstep the next day.
Right.
You know, because they're growing everywhere, but you don't have to buy from Amazon. But just do some research, because if you're trying to take your show to the next level, that's one of the ways you can do it, is by recording your show.
Yeah,
it's
getting
good quality. And when I representing some comics, I think that your EPK, your electronic press kit, needs to be good.
Yeah.
You know, because nowadays you're competing with that stuff, and you're competing with the next guy. And if you want to stand out, make sure you're not sending an agent a video with done shot on your iPhone.
Right.
That's now sideways or angly.
Right.
You know, and it's doing this.
You got
the whole time.
You know,
here you got a nice Manfrotto tripod. That's not a cheap tripod, but it makes the camera not move.
Right. Sure.
Right.
Yeah.
So, and that's an investment. Well, how successful do you want to be?
Well, it's a business.
You're
investing in your business anyway. I mean, it's all, and then you go that far, it's a write-off. You put in your taxes and everything else. It's all for
work.
And
that's another thing a lot of entertainers don't do. I became incorporated years ago. You need to become incorporated. Find someone that can do their taxes. You should pay yourself something every single quarter. Is something? It doesn't matter. You need to learn to do that, because it becomes a habit in your life. And once you listen, they say if you do something for 21 days, it becomes a habit in your life.
Right.
So if you can do something like working out 21 days, you'll get the first week, it's going to suck.
Right.
You know, if you're trying to lose weight, eating properly, it's going to suck.
Right.
So those become habits. And so when you can learn to exponentially do those things, life will change.
Right.
But pay yourself first. Figure out a way to do that. Now you go, Glenn and Lenny, I can't do that. You got to start somewhere. You know, just $10.
Yeah.
Because it's your business.
Yeah.
And if you treat it like a business, you know, you're going to be great. And the other thing is, it's be grateful that you're working. Don't, you know, I see a lot of people out there who are constantly looking at, like, you know, not constantly, but they're trashing people.
Yeah.
Get out of that mindset. That's not healthy for you.
Right. No, it's not. No, it's toxic.
It is very toxic.
And it causes negativity in you and around you.
Absolutely.
And it attracts negative people.
Absolutely.
So then it's just a massive curmudgeon.
And you know, and guy, every comedian that I represent, I've told them time and time again, I say, listen, I'm going to monitor your social media feed, not because I'm your boss. I'm not your boss. I'm here to work for you.
Right.
However, there are other people who might be watching what you're posting. That one person might be the next person who's responsible for booking you. And if you've said something that they didn't like, whether it's political, the religious views, whatever the case may be, only takes once for you to get cut. So you look, guys like yourself who work for multiple cruise lines, guys like George, who's been with Carnival for 30 years, that doesn't happen by accident. That happens because you're good people.
Yeah.
That happens because you're funny, obviously, and people love you. And I'm just grateful that you asked me to be a part of this amazing podcast.
Yeah, dude, this is great. So, thank you. Oh, we got to wrap it up, but did you...
you want to see a quick magic
do it.
Trick?
Hell yeah, I do.
All right, okay.
Do you need how much room? I want to make sure you
see
the monitor.
I can zoom out, too.
Let's
see here, because I'll just need my hand. Oh, how's that? Right there.
Is that good for you?
Yeah.
All right,
right
man.
There. Is that good there?
Yeah, good.
All right, so you can still hear me and everything's good. All right, so... right here. Can you see this?
Yeah, I can see it.
You see that's one, two, three, four, five $1 bills. Yes?
Yes.
Okay, one, two, three, four, five. Got it?
Got it.
All right, I want you to name a number between one and five.
Four.
One, two, three, four. That's the bill right here. Fair enough? I'm going to put it on top.
Okay.
Okay? And I'm going to hand it to you so you can examine it.
Okay.
Right, I want you to examine it. Make sure that's a $1 bill, because that's the one I'm going to use. That's a one?
That's a one.
Very good. Watch very closely. The thing I love about magic is that it's all about perception. Five $1 bills looks like this.
Oh,
that's 100, 200, 300, 400, five $100 bills. That's the one you touched. That's 100, that's two, that's three, that's four, that's five $100 bills. And that, my friend, is how you make money.
Dude, it's amazing.
Dude, that's incredible, dude.
How did you pull that off?
I love that.
Do you leave the $500 now?
Yes. Here's a funny story. As you and I know, we travel a lot from different third world countries sometimes.
Right.
When I'm traveling, I don't travel with that anymore. I only do that when I'm doing U.S. tours.
Oh, really?
And here's why. If I ever got mugged,
yeah,
I would not want to lose $500.
Of course, yeah.
So I do, which is unique, I do $1 to $2 bills.
Okay.
Which most people have never seen.
Sure, yeah.
And then I have a way to take those $2 bills and convert them to 20s like that.
All right.
And so now I'm out 100 and whatever, $10, if that were to be the case.
Trick on the whether or not you get mugged.
Yeah. And it's really funny because sometimes at the counter at the airlines, I'll do this for like somebody and to pay for stuff. I do it to pay for stuff all the time. I'm like, how much is it? She goes, it's, you know, $30. I'm like, oh man, I only have five.
Yeah.
I do it for the people.
Oh, no
and
way.
They're like, we can't take
They can't take the money. No, they got to be, that's like a three-card money. Well, everybody slow down. Slow down. Everyone stop. And they're looking at the card, the infrared.
I was on American Airlines flying home from, I want to say it was Grand Cayman one time, and the lady would not take the $100 to save her life because I had to pay for my luggage.
Right.
And there was like five people, and then they were bringing security cameras. They were like, we're going to watch the footage. And they're like, what's your phone number? And in case this bill goes back to a one.
We want to know if this is a fake bill, write down your name and address. Yeah. You should write it all down for them and then give it to them, and then it disappears. You can do that. Yeah. Come back here.
So that was been a fun experience.
Dude, that's hilarious.
I love doing that. And back in the day when we made some really decent money, sometimes I would just give it. I'd do it in a show, and I would do it, and I'd give it to a kid.
Oh yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah,
that had to be cool.
That gets all a little jazz. Pricey though.
Yeah, I bet that's you can write it off though.
No, it's a stunt, but it impacts them. You know.
Yeah, it does. Are you kidding me? That's cool.
Thanks, man.
All right, man. All right, Glen Foster. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Social media tags. What do you want to plug?
Yeah, hashtag GF Magic on Instagram. On Facebook, just Glen Foster. You can find me on YouTube as well under Glen Foster. If you want to learn some magic tricks, if you go to fostermagic.com, that is my website. There's a link that says free magic tricks that you can do at home with household items. And I also have a little magic kit that I sell that if someone's starting in magic, they can get started. And even if they don't want the magic kit, I can point you in the right directions or where to go, especially sometimes parents want their kids or their kids want to get started. I can save them thousands of dollars because I know what to get, not to get, and to help the parents save some money. And then also on Facebook, I'm under Magician Glen Foster fan page, but I primarily use like the Instagrams and I do a little TikTok, but like I say in my show, if you can find me, great, because I can't find myself sometimes on TikTok.
Nice. Awesome. Dude,
thank you. Guys. And Lenny, thank you for having me, buddy.
Of course, man. Thank you.